The Wildlife concert marks his first live recording in 20 years. It took place a few blocks away at the Sony Music Studios, and his fans from around the world tuned in for it. Call it a New York City high. Call him John Denver, and he'll be here in just a minute. He sings about Rocky Mountains, country roads, and sunshine, but his humanitarian efforts are definitely global. He burst on the scene when he wrote Leaving on a Jet Plane for Peter, Paul, and Mary, and now he pilots his own Learjet. He has a new CD, which we'll show you in a minute here, a television special that was terrific, and he's just about to do what most talented performers do when they tour and share their music with everybody. And I'll tell you, he's singing better than ever. I saw him the other night on tape, and he is terrific. John Denver is here. John, good to see you.
Roger, thank you.
Okay, why are you so busy? I mean, everybody goes through ups and downs. I hadn't seen you for a little while. Now you're out there doing everything.
Well, and that's it. At one time, I think I was the biggest selling record artist in the world for a couple years, and I went from that to not even having a record deal. And as you say, it goes up and it goes down, and it's starting to come back up again, and I want to take advantage of that.
Is that because of something that's going on with you? Is it going on with the audience taste, or is it the music business that artists sort of get hot, get cold, whatever?
Oh, I think it's all three of those things. And I have a very, very loyal following, and I have, even in these recent concerts, the audience is changing. They're both those people who are my age and the kids who were raised in my music are now young men and women, and they're coming to the concerts, and there's new little kids. And so I'm enjoying that a whole lot.
Are you still doing some of the early music when you
work?
Oh, yes.
All right. Oh, yes. I do songs that really cover my whole career. The hits that I think most people expect to hear in concert, some of the more obscure things from albums that were successful and some that weren't so successful, and then a lot of new things.
What mistakes have you made in your career? Any?
I think the biggest mistake that I made was turning down an officer and a gentleman.
Really?
Yes, sir. I was
great
film.
You were up for that. Gear took it, huh?
Gear got it,
you know? That was a good film, too.
It was a great film, and I think in my naivete, I couldn't see in the script the film that it turned out to be.
Ah.
And I suppose, to a degree, I'm a little bit picky. You know, when Oh God came around, I didn't want to do a movie just to do a movie. And we had been offered quite a few things when all of a sudden I got the script to Oh God and knew that that's what I wanted to do.
Working with George Burns. How old was he then? About 112? And
I think we celebrated his 85th birthday during the filming.
During the filming.
Yes,
so
sir.
He's over 95 now. So he's.
I think he's going to be 100 this year, isn't he?
Wow.
We're getting close to it.
Go back to Officer and Gentleman. Is that what you really like to do now, act?
I would like to do more acting. I really enjoyed that enormously, and I think I can do it a little bit. But as I've learned in singing, I think it takes a lot of practice. It takes a lot of experience to really develop any talent like that. And I would like very much to do more acting.
Tell me about the Wildlife concert.
Well, it was an idea that happened a long time ago with a friend of mine who works for the Wildlife Conservation Society. And he was a big fan of my music. It had had a big effect on his life, I think. And he was seemingly even more frustrated than I about that down part of the cycle. And he wanted me to do something on television, and he kept after it until he got some people involved where it started to be a real thing about a year ago. And over the process of that, of maybe 9 months, it got to where it included the A&E Network and Sony, and this is what we have.
Are you really, I know that you've been called an environmentalist, and most people don't know what that means because I think all of us want to preserve the environment to some degree. It's a question of trade-offs in society. Where would you put yourself on a scale of 1 to 10 on the
I would say I'm probably a 10.
Are you?
Yeah.
So you're over there with Al Gore.
Oh, definitely.
Yeah. Would you like to see him president?
I don't know that. I don't know him well enough. And I think Mr. Clinton's going to be the next president again anyway.
You do?
Yes, sir.
Gore said cars are the worst thing that ever for the environment. Yeah, I mean,
well,
so I don't think he's going to get a lot of votes in Detroit. That's my point. And I'm not sure whether Learjets pollute the environment or not. I suspect not much.
The same thing. And you know, as you suggest, what are the trade-offs? And where are the sacrifices that we're willing to make when we truly begin to understand how much we need wilderness?
Mm-hmm.
You know, for me, the big trade-off there, we talk about air quality, we talk about water quality, ozone depletion, there are so many things. Mm-hmm. But a part of that is nature. Nature in its rawest form, which is wilderness. And that's a part, I believe, of what makes us human beings. And sometime we're going to have to find a balance between the resources that we think we need and what we're losing that is truly irreplaceable.
The environmentalists, I mean, there are people who are sort of pro-business growth, and then they're always at odds with the environmentalists. Why can't there seem to be a trade that says, hey, we've got to have jobs and we've got to have the environment, which means we've got to compromise on everything a little bit?
Well, we do have to find ways to compromise, but I think there's so much that goes on in our world, in our society, that polarizes people. And it doesn't have to be that way. We don't have to polarize the issues, really. But we do have to find a way to achieve a kind of balance which promotes both a sustainable future, and I don't think we're living that in this country right now, and a healthy environment. And recognize that healthy environment, again, is a part of our lives. Why do you think in this city they still have Central Park? When real estate is so valuable in this place and there's so much business going on here, how come they still have Central Park?
They need a place to commit the crimes.
I never thought of that.
No, the guy who invented Central Park did a great service for this city because people have no place to go where they can get outside and see grass and so on.
And see spring happening.
Actually, Rudy Giuliani's a friend of mine. I have to take that statement back. I'll get a call from Rudy. I saw him the other night at dinner and say, Ailes, they don't have crimes in Central Park. Quit telling people that. Actually, they do have a few, but I mean, don't hang out there around 2 in the morning. But most weekends, it's still a gorgeous place to go.
It's a glorious place any time of the day and right. In the evening, and I suppose you have to be a little careful when it gets real dark.
Yeah, yeah. As you do almost anywhere.
Just about anywhere.
Anybody, what's the crime rate in Aspen?
Not nearly what it is here.
Really?
Although it's
a lot of rich guys out there, though. I mean, it's a target-rich environment, let's put it that way, for robbery.
When I first moved there, I never locked my door. I never cared about that. And now I find myself periodically, I'll lock my car, and I lock my door.
Hmm. When did you first go out there?
I moved in Aspen in 1970.
Did you do anything that got your career cold for a while, or did you just get tired? Because you're still one of the biggest top five record sellers of all time or something. I mean, you sold more music than almost anybody. And then for a while, you just kind of like didn't want to do it, or what?
Well, there were a whole lot of things. One of the major things, I think, for me in that decline was both my wanting to stick to the music that I do. I don't want to be told what to record by anybody. I think I earned the right to do what I do. That's where I had my big success. And I'm not going to do a bunch of country songs just because somebody thinks I'm a country artist or that's what they want to sell from me.
They try to move you in that direction when country got real hot?
It was more after the fact. What I was addressing most specifically is the trends that were changing at that time.
Right.
And then later on, trying to get some of my new recordings out, they weren't country enough for the mm-hmm. people that I talked to. And I said, well, this is the album.
This is what I do.
Another thing that happened is that RCA was sold to General Electric. And at the time that happened, there was really nobody left at RCA who had been connected to my career or to my success. So there was nobody who really had John Denver as something they wanted to work for. And there were a lot of new guys with a lot of new people that they wanted to push. And I had a heck of a record deal. And I think General Electric looked at it and said, we got to pay this guy this much money just for delivering an album, and he's selling enough, we're going to have to pay him more to get a new contract. I think we better let him go. And it looks like he's going downhill, and I had fired my manager at that point, and so that's what happened.
Did that tear you up personally at all? Did you feel like maybe it was over at any point?
No. I understand the ups and downs to a degree. I remember the time I went to a radio station once in Chicago on a promotion tour for the second single record I think I ever had, which was Follow Me. And they didn't have time to see me.
You're kidding.
Oh, no. And then later on, they were begging me to stop by their station. So, you know, you get to see both sides of it. And I also understand that when you have the kind of success that I did, that probably the other side of it is going the other side of it is going to be equal.
I got to take a break, John. We'll be right back. We're talking to John Denver. This is the new CD, double CD, The Wildlife Concert. We'll be right back with more questions for John right after this message.
Country road, take me home to the place.
John Denver, right after these messages.
Colorado, Rocky Mountain High. I've seen it rain and fire in the sky. The shadow from the star.
Jerry.
Oh, God.
That's right.
Is that you?
In person.
You're not on the radio?
Have you got a radio out here?
No.
Bingo.
You're here? In my bathroom?
Come take a look.
I can't. I'm naked.
You think I don't know what you've got?
What do you think when you see that?
I love it. That was a great, great experience in my life. It was a thrill, a privilege to work with someone like George Burns and Carl Reiner, and it was great.
When did you know you could act? Because I'll tell you something, playing comedy is hard. Mm-hmm. I mean, I've directed theater, and I understand about that, and finding somebody, particularly a singer, because it's a different kind of acting in a song. In a way.
Well, it is, but still you're recreating every night what that song means to you, especially
right.
If the songs, you know, I don't just sit down every day and write a song.
Right.
These songs come out of my own experiences, my own emotions, my own vision for the world, and they're very personal to me. And to recreate that every night, there is acting involved. And then, you know, you need help, you need, you know, the cast, you need the director, and you need to find out what you can do. You need to be willing to stretch a little bit. And I, as I said earlier, I really enjoyed acting. I'd like to do more. I haven't found out yet that I can.
Are you inhibited? Because one of the things about an actor, of course, a lot of actors are inhibited as people. But when they become somebody else, they're fine.
Yeah.
I mean, Richard Gere told me that he's very shy and laid back as a person. But when he's in a scene, he can do whatever he has to do.
Well, when that's your job, I think I can do that. I haven't really been challenged in that way. I think, you know, really strongly challenged. Oh God, to a large degree, was just being myself, you know, and that's not exactly who I am. Mm-hmm. But I think that was an easy one for me.
We were talking in the break about women, ladies and gentlemen, because John and I have both been around a few years and have actually met a couple of women in our time. And the world's changed, and you're a little nervous about dating now.
Well, you mean the world has changed just in my life?
Well, your life, and it's changed in general. I mean, now you're a big, successful guy. Don't you wonder when a girl goes out with you, is she going out with you because you're a star and you can sing, or because it's really about you?
Well, no, I think I can tell that before I ask somebody out, and I don't ask anybody out who fits that particular mold. Mm-hmm. But what does scare me, and right now I'm scared to death of women, and it feels like if you give them any attention at all of a sudden they feel you're in a relationship. And I don't want to be in a relationship, a committed relationship right now. I can't do that. It's not possible. Although I would like to have that, and that's what I thought I had in my last marriage.
What happened in your last marriage?
Well, I think, as seems to happen an awful lot, once you get married, all of a sudden it turns out to be a different person in some respects. Or some things that you thought might change once you married, made that commitment, didn't change. And it's very, very difficult.
Have you ever met a woman who didn't want to change a man?
I don't think so.
I rest my case.
But that's not true. I have some women friends, and very few, but the women friends that I have mean the world to me, and they are women who are not trying to change me.
Mm-hmm.
But when you get in that relationship, ooh, I just don't know. It starts getting
gives
me the shivers.
Yeah,
yeah.
What's the first sign? The first sign was when they begin to criticize something that seemed okay.
No,
originally.
I don't think that's quite it. It's this feeling of attachment to the situation where sometimes things are taken personally that should not be taken personally. Mm-hmm. And in that, they're trying to hold on in ways that don't feel appropriate or comfortable. Right.
Yeah. Tell me about your kids.
I have three wonderful kids. Two of them are adopted. My son Zach is 21 now. He's at Fort Lewis College in Durango. He's a wonderful guy. He's black and American Indian. He's got the brightest smile in the universe, I think. My daughter Anna Kate is 18.
Oh, you got a shot on the.
Anna Kate is 18. She's a ballet dancer. She is going to go to Dartmouth. She's just brilliant and just such a lady. God, I love her so much. And little Jessie Bell there, she's a firecracker. She's 6 years old, and she brightens up my life.
She looks like she's got Daddy pretty well wrapped up there.
You better believe it. I try to pretend it's not so, but I think she knows.
Yeah,
how do they know?
They can spot it, I can tell you. Little girls can
And where do these little
it.
Girls get it?
They got, boy, it's in
is
the genes.
Is it osmosis or it's in the genes?
It's in the genes, man. I don't know what it is. You did a lot of work, humanitarian-type work. You worked for Jimmy Carter on World Hunger. People have been talking about that now for 20 years. Is it getting any better out there or not?
I think it's getting enormously better. And in fact, one of the things that I've learned just recently through the Hunger Project, which is an organization that I helped found, when we started the Hunger Project, there was no way of measuring hunger in the world. And people who were with us found what we call the infant mortality rate. And that determines the number of deaths per 1,000 births in the first year of life. Mm-hmm. And it's more than 50. We say, and it's pretty well been accepted now, that hunger is a societal problem in that country. Mm-hmm. When we started the Hunger Project, the average birth rate around the world, or the infant mortality rate, was more than 100. It's now in the 60s. Now, that doesn't mean that there's not still poverties of real hunger in the world, and there's not a lot to be done. But it is changing, and I believe that we will live up to our commitment based on this rating that by the year 2000, hunger as a societal world problem will not be existent.
John, it's good to see you back working as much as you are. Take a look at the CD. Get a close-up there. There he is, the Wildlife Concert. John Denver, singing better than ever. Great to see you, John.
Roger, nice to be with you. Thanks.
Nice to be with you.